suddenly.
Here we go.
Pressure's on.
No, we're good.
Okay, so today we are hanging out with Professor Ali Fenwick. This has honestly been something we've been looking forward to all season. So for our guest, Professor Ali Fenwick, I mean, is there something that you haven't done? Professor, CEO, consultant, podcaster now, if we
got
may
a podcast let, nowadays, yeah.
If we can let that out of the bag. And then also our little, not little, our social media
yes.
superstar.
TikTok superstar.
Yeah, I think I wouldn't call 1 million TikTok followers little.
No.
So thank you
and growing.
So much.
And,
yes.
and growing.
Yes, we have to love an algorithm.
First of all, thank you for having me over. I've also been super excited to be sitting with you guys here today and just having this conversation with you. And very much looking forward. I mean, come on, when have I actually sat down, you know, and had this conversation? Can I say students?
We were your students.
Yeah, almost, yeah. I mean, I've never. Yeah. Yeah, but look, now
we were in your class, and that's how this podcast was born. That's
absolutely.
Where we met.
Exactly, brainchild of management psychology.
Yeah.
Well, we have, but I'm kind of like, I've never had this kind of sit down with you guys before, or any other student for that matter of fact. Yeah. And then, because I think this is also great, you get to know the other, I get to know you a bit better, and you get to know me a bit better, and the world gets to know us a little bit better. So I'm super excited about today.
Yeah.
So perfect. Thanks for having me here.
You're welcome. It's awesome to have you. I mean, just as you said, it's a lot of people, you know you out there from class, but the millions of people, you know, see you, you know, giving advice on social media or doing like really brief,
dances. You can
exactly.
say it, don't worry.
Exactly. So this is a great opportunity for people to get to know you more, you know?
Yeah.
And obviously this is, we're excited to jump right in.
Super.
Right in.
Let's get
sure.
started.
For sure. Absolutely.
So tell us, what sparked your interest in exploring behavioral science and psychology as a career?
Yeah, that's a great question. Look, I didn't start my career as a behavioral scientist. You know, I always say you either you're a born academic or you're a made academic. I'm a made academic. So I started my career. My first degree was actually in Japanese language and linguistics. So wow. I studied Japanese. I worked for a Japanese company for many years. So I'm pretty good in Japanese. I speak Japanese, write Japanese. But, you know, eventually just along my career, I was like, I wanted to do something else in life. And so I embarked on an MBA, similar to you guys, long, long time ago. And after 2 years, I was like, okay, got my degree, and I had to go back to work. And I was, I was working at the same time, but I freaked out. I was like, I'm going to get bored. They gave me a promotion, luckily. but I was like, I need to do something more. Like, I kind of felt like that, you know, this is what happens. You study and then there's this gap and
absolutely.
You need to fill that void. And I remember there were two of my colleagues in class, and I asked them, like, what are you going to do? Like, oh, we're going to do a PhD. I'm like, really? Like, can you do a PhD while you're working? And they were like, yeah, we can do it. And so I said, well, maybe I'll join you. How much is it? And he's like, oh, God, that's so much cheaper than an MBA.
True.
So I was like,
if you survive an MBA, then you're good.
Yeah. If you survive, you're still good. So I was kind of like, I didn't have enough, so I just wanted to continue. And then I thought, what am I going to investigate? And I've always been, look, I guess coming back to the question, why did you study behavioral science? You know, I was brought up in a very multicultural environment. My mom was English, dad Spanish. You know, brought up in the Netherlands, lived in Spain, lived in UK, lived in Denmark, lived in Japan, all the different countries. And I was fascinated about how people operate. How they think and why they behave the way they do and why are they so different, but also why are they so similar regardless of culture. And that really got to me. And of course, working in a Japanese organization, you learn so much about the nonverbal cues and how, you know, the perspectives that people bring to the table that can be so different than in a different culture, that I kind of wanted to dive under the hood. So my initial idea, actually, when I started with my PhD, was more around relationships in organizations and you know, cross-cultural differences between people. But then every time I got further into my PhD, it was like I was getting deeper into the cognitive side and into the psychology of things. And then having a conversation with my professors, like, it seems like you're moving away from Japan and you're moving more into the mind. So, you know, and she was really good in guiding me in that perspective. So then I fell in love with behavioral science. and studying not just only kind of the field of, you know, work psychology, but I had to know the fundamentals of social psychology and cognitive psychology, evolutionary psychology. So instead of taking 4 years to finish your PhD, it took me 7 years. Yeah, yeah, a lot. So because of my love for the science and really wanting to grasp.
So you were more engulfed with like further research.
Yeah, yeah, oh, wow. totally. Because I felt like if you, yeah, you can tackle a question from a behavioral perspective or like a scientific perspective, but I really wanted to understand more about how does the brain function? How does it work?
The inner workings.
Yeah, exactly. And so that's what, you know, that's what drove me more into the behavioral science field. And at the same time, I felt that I wanted to transition into something new. And I was working for this Japanese company for many years. And I wanted to do something that was more related to behavior and science. And at 2012, 2013 was, you know, behavioral economics became a very big thing at that time. You know, Dan Ariely. Daniel Kahneman's work inspired a lot of people at that time to think about, you know, we can also apply psychology, not just in a clinical setting. We can also apply it in a practical way.
Yeah.
We can help people to make better decisions for themselves. And I thought that was fascinating, right? And this is not marketing. This is behavioral science applied in a way that can help people to become better. And so that was what drove me. And I guess with that kind of focus, I always just started realizing that it was more the resilience side of things, of what don't we know about the brain? How can we make people healthier and happier and wealthier by understanding how the brain works and the interaction that they have with the environment? And that was what eventually drove a lot of my research today, right? So I understand some parts of the clinical aspects of things, but that was not what I was trained in. And so I was trained more in the behavioral side of things and helping people to become the better versions of themselves in all aspects of life, from work, personal life, now relationships more, et cetera. So that's what sparked my interest and in where I am today.
I feel like that behavioral aspect, so away from the clinical, you know, sense, is more more relatable or more, accessible to the masses, you know, other than the clinical side. Mm. So it's like having these keys, you know, presented to you,
right?
You know, from you any walk of life, everything. You can unlock, man, it's crazy.
Yeah.
And now, sorry, to throw in your work on AI, because I know that's also something that interests you. So then, you know, I mean, from psychology feeding into
it's another sort of behavior, you know?
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of like we've just summed up the work in the field of behavioral science, like 15 years now, we're going to do something else. But the thing of AI, so as my organization was growing, in terms of working with different clients and eventually started working more into the public sector, where behavioral science, you know, traditionally has been more applied than in the private sector. Like you said, now it's kind of, you know, it's started to grow. That the field of AI and technology is starting to become much more important. And I think already in 2016, 2017, I started working with clients where they were looking at behavioral science in terms of app development, website development, because, you know, behavioral science and technology do go hand in hand. And then came this concept of how can we personalize messages, nudging, how can we nudge you to do something?
Yes.
And we think about nudging in a physical sense, like creating an environment that makes people to make better choices for themselves. But with the online environment, you can actually influence people in a personal way. And so a lot of my work started to go more into that direction. I worked with a couple of companies also in the last couple of years to help them to build their behavioral architecture for technology. And I started seeing, and also during the pandemic, I thought, okay, I need to do something, right? Mm. So I got my master's in artificial intelligence as well.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so, and I wanted to because, you know, a lot of my colleagues were talking about it, but I really wanted to dive into it and know the workings of it. Mm. And then when I did my master's, I started to see a tremendous overlap between psychology, behavioral science, in AI. And as AI advances, these two, you know, schools of thoughts are actually coming together because the more it advances, the more psychology we need to have for it.
Of course.
Yeah. So I guess a lot of my work now is looking at how can we infuse that, but also what is the impact of, you know, AI and our digital experiences on the psychology of people. And that's something that a lot of us don't know about yet. And so that's why I'm kind of feel that my evolution is going more into the technology field, fused together with the psychology field as well.
Do you feel Do you have like, okay, this is like a bit off topic. Do you have the kind of fear of AI moving forward, that, you know, that general sort of worry, concern, it's going to take over the world?
No. Well, look, I think that's a fear that a lot of people have. Mm. And I have something very interesting to say about that. So I guess the fear of AI taking, especially now with this generative AI and stuff, and a lot of people falsely believe, there's this illusion that AI has become so super intelligent. It hasn't. Mm. Today, we're using something called weak AI.
Yes.
Weak AI is this very narrow AI. It's like you have a specific function, like roll the dice, let the car roll, come up with words that you could predict that come after other words, which is this ChatGPT. But the technology is still weak AI. The thing is why it seems so impressive, it's been trained on billions and billions of data, right? And words, so that it knows and kind of can predict what other words, probability wise, could come after. And so I think a lot of people now have kind of gotten scared, like, oh my God, this is what AI can do. And a lot of the, you know, the advocates, the AI evangelists are saying, well, wait a minute, look, this technology is going so fast. You know, it could, even weak AI, this is what I'm saying, can fool a human being, let alone, let's wait for more kind of advanced AI to come out, what it could do to us.
Imagine that capture thing. Yes. You heard about that.
Yeah, exactly. And I think that's a well-founded fear. But there's also another kind of fear, and there's this kind of fear that we just generally have towards technology. And what's very interesting is that when you talk about fear, there's a difference in culture and how they look at AI. So we, from like the last 80, 90 years, even in the time of Frankenstein, we've always wanted to create artificial life. But we've in the West, especially through our literature, we've looked at you know, AI as potentially killing us and taking over. Think of Terminator. Yeah. And recently the movie Megan, right? Yes. The doll.
Yes.
In the end, she says, I'm going to take over. You know, and that's what she, you know, and then again, it's feeding into this fear of AI. So we, through our literature and stories and drama, whatnot, and drama, have this perception of AI being fearful or taking over is there. And that's why also a lot of us nowadays are fearful of actually having to work with AI in the workplace. Mm. And we don't think about that. However, in the Eastern culture, such as in Japan, for example, AI has always been positioned as something that saves life.
Supports life,
exactly. Mm. So that's why we're seeing more developments along the lines of robots and people more willing to work with robots.
Even decades ago.
Yeah. So
not even recently. You know, just to serve the coffee.
Yes.
Yeah.
You know, I remember the first time I walked into, I think it was the Diwa Customer Happiness Center. And this was in 2020,
right?
And I walk into the customer happiness center, and here is this robot, and this robot rolls up to me. And I was actually startled, because I'm like, no, I don't want to deal with you. I want to deal with the person.
Exactly. You please know,
it's
try
admin,
me.
Yeah. Number one, give me a person. But I was startled.
Because
I was not expecting it.
It's so funny how with that being prevalent, us humans always still want that human interaction. We're always like, no, I want to speak to a real person. Please give me a chance. You know, give me a chance. That's crazy.
Yeah. Mm. So that's also even that aspect, that interaction between robots and people. Mm. How does that affect us psychologically? And what makes it more acceptable and less acceptable? Those are questions that I'm also thinking about as well.
So, you know, one thing that I picked up while following your TikToks is, you know, you've leaned into this whole concept of the fact that the more we are becoming attached to our screens, the more we are distancing ourselves socially, and that's impacting our personal relationships, our work relationships, and all of that. So, you know, with AI coming in, and, you know, people have fear that AI is going to be replacing jobs. And all of us, I don't know, as social as we want to be post-COVID, I still find people are so just attached to their devices. And I think in one of your TikToks, you also said people don't want to make calls anymore because it's too anxious. Much connectedness,
it's too
right?
too close, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, that's absolutely right. Yeah, no, look, that's a great observation. There's multiple reasons why this is happening. So first of all, if we look at apps and app design, the way that these apps have been built to persuade your behavior, to influence your behavior. So Anira Yal, who wrote the book Hooked, he created this kind of model and said, you know, they're there to kind of capture your attention. You have to trigger the behavior. And then when you trigger the behavior, you take action because you anticipate that you're going to get some kind of reward. But when you do this unexpectedly, when you don't know what you're going to get on your feed or who's going to connect with you, who sends you a message or notification pops up, that unexpectedness is part of that building that addiction inside of you. And so what's happening is people, through persuasive technology design, are actually influencing you to become more focused on your screens. And even though we think, hey, you know, I'm connecting with multiple people nowadays and I'm doing that through my phone and WhatsApp and whatnot, I'm social. But actual social media is not that social.
Yeah.
Why is it not that social? Because one, it isolates you. Yeah. You don't want to be in contact with people. You cancel meetings more frequently. Yeah. When people actually use filters, then less likely to meet people in real life. Yes. I can go on and on and on. And also this kind of like continuous like dopamine hits that people are getting is affecting people's ability to their sensitivity to things. They're becoming more insensitive.
Yes.
And because there's a screen between a human and another human and the distance, perceived distance, we therefore think that we can treat people differently. And that's why I also often talk about dating in relationships and why dating has become so toxic nowadays and why we mistreat people, because we have so many options available now that if it doesn't work with you, why should I fix it? It's so much easier to find someone else.
Next.
Right? Yeah. Or you're so far away from you, I could just mistreat you because there's no consequences to me. And so I think the bigger problem is it's the technology that's causing this problem. And like when Facebook puts you into a cluster because it's good for advertising, they don't realize that they're isolating you and not allowing you to have more diverse thinking, which might polarize behavior even more.
That's very true.
Yeah. So there's so many reasons why our behaviors are changing. But I think technology foundationally at the core has a huge role to play in that. And that's one of the other reasons why I'm getting into this field, because I feel we need to humanize AI. We need to find ways to improve how we design technology with the intent to make people happier and more connected.
Not just about the bottom line.
No, it's not only about the bottom line. Yeah.
So with the research and with, you know, all of that, all of these ventures, how did you, you know, let me turn it around. Yeah. How did you sort of, you know, position yourself? I mean, you're on, you know, multiple campuses.
Where does he find the time?
You know, multiple campuses all over the world.
Yeah.
How do you do it?
How do you do it? I actually got that question today also. It's like, you know, how can you do so much work at the same time? Well, I guess that's how my brain works, right? I'm someone that is, I love high performance. I think high performance is something that, again, coming back to my research in resilience and performance, I've learned over the many years of what can help you to be more focused, more concentrated. How do you, you know, elevate your levels, and how do you find time to kind of relax more? So using behavioral science has been kind of like, I've been my own guinea pig. When I see that it has worked with other people, I've started to implement it in my life. And then I find those things that work well. For example, one of the things that helped me to transition into moving more into behavioral science and also the company and teaching is stay focused to your values. One thing that when I worked for this previous company is I was doing the job, I was making lots of money. I loved the job that I was doing. But at the same time, I didn't feel that the work that I was doing really fit with my values 100%. One of my key values that I've learned over time was, I remember around 34, 35, I was working, but I was so misaligned with who I am and what I wanted to do and the work that I was actually doing that I didn't burn out, but I kind of felt this is not going the right way. Mm-hmm. And that was that reflection.
You felt that impact.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. And I was like, what is that the thing that I want that's important to me? And I realized that autonomy was really important to me. Mm-hmm. That's my number one value. You tell me what to do and I'll back off. You give me the reins to allow myself to make my decisions, and I will work 5 times harder for you than anyone else will. And that was that's a reflection, right? Wow. You need to know that about yourself. So how does this tie back into what you're now asking? I think the moment that you align yourself with your core values and your strengths, and I'm a night person, you know, everyone, all my colleagues know, I function so much better at night, but unfortunately that's not how the world works. Yeah. And so my most creative time happens at night. And, you know, so I have all this creative production for my TikToks and my reels at night, also for my teaching. And then during the day, I just kind of deliver and teach and do. And once you find that circadian rhythm that works well for you, it is phenomenal how you can go from what I thought was 100% 10 years ago Now I look at it and it's like, that's 15%, you know? Wow. And I think I've optimized my life, but to your point, you know, you can, optimization is really important, but there also has to be a threshold. You need to know what your limits are. Yeah. Because without knowing that, you can't deliver at high performance. So yeah, I hope that kind of answers that more from like a personal perspective.
For sure.
So if you were going to give, let's say, two pieces of advice to somebody who wants to up their game from a behavioral psychology perspective, what would you suggest they do to improve their own performance? So agnostic of whether you are in a great working environment or a toxic one, but if you want to take it upon yourself and you're like, okay, I want to change this about me, what would you say we should focus on?
Oh, brilliant question. I love that. You really, as you were saying that, I was thinking like, what's the right answer? But I think number one is learning to know yourself by far. Get to know yourself. And sometimes you need to, you need to throw yourself into these real life experiences and you need to screw up.
Make mistakes.
You need to screw up and experiment and be okay to experiment. So two things I say, know yourself, but also throw yourself into new situations. Don't get too scared and stuck. And as you try out new things, you'll find out what you like and what you don't like and what you're good at and what you're not good at, and try different foods that make you happy and more energetic, and foods that don't make you so energetic. So knowing yourself, experiment. And number three, part of upping your game is, don't think that you are only a worker. You are a holistic human being. That means you're a spiritual being, you're a physical being. Go to the gym. I go to the gym regularly. I take care of my health. I take care of what I eat. So look at yourself from a holistic perspective, because we can often lose that in the heat of the moment, or, you know, when life takes over, we just think about work. Right. But we're more than work and social connection. Yes. I think that's really important.
It makes a lot of sense. Once you, you know, tick all these boxes, and as you said, that holistic view, you definitely, you know, get your game on for sure.
Yeah.
While you were sort of researching yourself.
Yeah.
Did you sort of explore or find out any misconceptions about, you know, behavioral science as a concept?
Huh. Well, look, let me just explain. Behavioral science is a very broad, because often we equate it with psychology, right?
Yeah.
It's sociology, it's anthropology. Behavioral science is kind of like a big umbrella.
Yeah.
Exactly. So within the field of psychology, I think one of the biggest misconceptions, When we have certain findings about, you know, things that have worked in behavioral science, like, oh, did you hear about this fascinating insight? And if you do this, it's going to help this. And if you're going to do that, that's going to inform that. And one of the big issues, and this is not only for the field of psychology, but other behavioral science fields, is the replication issue. So the problem of, you know, scientists now trying to replicate, you know, experiments that were done in the past or in the field of behavioral economics, and they're not giving the same results. And I think that's a big problem. And so we're kind of getting into this quick evaluation phase of what's real and what's not. And because a lot of these experiments are not replicating, it is hurting the field. And I think that's something we need to be more aware of. I talk about it. I talk about this. Did you know that you can influence people this way? And did you know? But we need to be more realistic. And it's going through kind of it's going through like a winter. Like it's going through a winter phase right now. And and I think we need to get out of it. And I think it's good for the field. And the second thing that I, you know, a lot of the research, think about it. I mean, the biggest universities in the world have been, you know, after the Second World War, the U.S. has dominated as a power, as a superpower. And so as business leaders around the world, out of the U.S., we have looked at U.S. thinking and education and science that has mainly come out of the Anglo-Saxon environments, such as the U.K. and the U.S.
Yeah.
And behavioral science is exactly that. Yeah. And so then when we see these examples, but they have not been replicated outside of the U.S., the U.K.
It's all engulfing. So there's not like a single manual that, you know, one size fits all.
No, 100%.
Yeah.
So in other words, we need to retest and reevaluate in every single country. And I have so many examples. I won't get into that now, but I have so many examples of what people think over here and they've read of a book. And then we tested that in China or in the Middle East or wherever. And we got completely different results. And that's missing. And more of that is needed. Even the digital space is now also a new space as well.
Yes.
So we have to retest and reevaluate.
Another environment,
for sure. Yeah. So a lot of people don't think about that, and that's very much necessary.
Okay. Yeah. So in your research, you know, have maybe one of your research projects, if you could talk us through something that you identified afterwards that you found surprising that you weren't expecting at all.
Oh, like an example.
Yeah.
Mm. Oh, goodness. I have so many.
We love a good
like
anecdote.
Like a wow moment. Like, oh my God.
I have some really good OMG. Anecdotes. Yeah. No, this is a real OMG case study. And again, the beautiful thing about behavioral science and psychology and experimenting, and this is why I gave that as one of the tools, because every time you experiment, you get to test your assumptions. And when the data comes in, and it challenges your assumptions. Some people are like, ho, 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 I'm not going to change my beliefs. You know what? But allow, so that I say always allow the data to kind of change your worldview. Now, one of those big shockers, I will never forget that again. I recently talked about that in my management psychology class, is when I bring people on board into our company, doesn't matter if you do marketing or your behavioral science or you're even admin, we have everyone participate like in an onboarding, you know, activity. Mm. And part of the first couple of weeks of onboarding, we asked them to read about behavioral science, about nudge, about psychology, etc. And then that's the first week. And then the second week we say, okay, now that you've read about this, which of these nudges or which of these kind of behavioral experiments would you like to replicate? So they get to actually work with real data and collect data. It's super fun.
Yeah.
And they're like, oh, I've never run an experiment before. But then they get kind of like a buddy. Sometimes I'm the buddy and I support them, right? Like a supervisor would. And then I say, okay, we're going to choose that one. So we choose a real life scenario and then they get to test the principle. Mm. And then they go out and collect the data real time. And they come back. And on Friday, within 5 days, on Friday, then they kind of prepare the presentation. And then I invite some people from the industry or customers or whoever on a casual Friday with some drinks. And then the person gives us a presentation and we ask about it. We challenge it. And sometimes I learned things that go like, wow. But this specific scenario was framing. So framing basically means you can frame things positively or negatively. And if we're completely rational, doesn't matter if you frame things positive or negative, you should always come up with the right answer. Mm. So give you an example. So let's say, for example, I say to you, you have to have surgery, God forbid that will happen. But let's pretend in this case you do. Doctor comes in and says, Adam, you need to have surgery today. Unfortunately, you have to have surgery today, but there's a 10% chance that you're going to die. Okay. And then I'll come to you and then I'll say, okay, well, you need to unfortunately have surgery today. But there's a 90% chance that you will survive. Which one sounds better?
Of course.
The positive one, right? But we should equally say, so basically...
Because the numbers are the same.
Yeah. The number's exactly the same. It's 10%.
It's perception, sides of the same coin.
Right. Mm-hmm. And then this is where Daniel Kahneman won the Nobel Prize for what he calls prospect theory, that we're not rational and we're more irrational, and that framing effect can actually influence our decision making. So we found a scenario, you know those cigarette packages?
Yes.
And it has those gory images on those packages, right? Yeah. And so we thought, wouldn't it be interesting if we try to figure out if those gory images actually prevent people from smoking? That's a behavioral challenge, right? Because you think about campaigns, like, smoking campaigns or anti-whatever campaigns, does that information really work? And if it did work, then people would actually stop smoking or do or not. And so we went out and tested it. And so to cut to the chase, we actually found... So first of all, let me ask you this. Do you think that those images actually make people stop smoking or prevent them from smoking? Mm. What do you think?
So I know the answer to this one, but only because we were in the class.
You've been in my class. Okay.
And we paid attention. Yeah, so exactly. We earned that A.
Yeah. We don't know.
Go on.
So it does impact people, but not in the way that you think.
Yes.
Yeah.
It actually makes them smoke more.
Exactly.
And people are like, wow. And this was a startling insight to us because of two things. The ostrich effect, which is kind of, I'm sticking my head in the sand as a coping mechanism and I'm in denial. So I'll just rip off the packet, not look at it, and I keep on smoking because I'm in denial, right? So people smoke more. And the other one is what they call in behavioral economics, the hyperbolic discounting effect. Mm. In other words, that image is so far away from how I look at myself today.
Exactly.
That's not me. So they keep on smoking.
10 years time.
Or I don't know anyone who's, you know, I'm fine. It's fine. Yeah.
And then as we dived into this, we figured out something very interesting. Those images are not for smokers. those images are to prevent children from smoking. Mm. Because most people who smoke in their adult years started when they were young. And the majority of them started between the years of 11 to 14, 15 years old. Isn't that crazy?
That's crazy.
So that completely changed our perspective of how to look at the
world. Exactly. It's not targeted to the adults. It's targeted to the kids.
Yeah. So that was just one example I want to share with you. That really, till today, still wowed me and the team as well. Yeah.
You know, I remember I would never have guessed that that would have been the outcome. But I guess, you know, that's what they say about assuming things makes sense.
Yeah.
SS out of you and me.
A homo economicus does not exist.
To some extent, we care about ourselves and we're self-interested. But I think the behavioral science has shown us that we're so much more complex than just a simple model. Yeah.
And I think we're just processing so many things at the same time. You cannot account for everything.
No. But that behavioral lens, what it does, it gives you a completely different perspective to the world. Mm. I don't think I look to the world like most people. Sometimes people are like, why did you react that way? Or why did you all of a sudden kind of make a different decision? Because I could see something potentially, the probability of it happening because of that lens that I have. And I know sometimes people are like, wow, I didn't expect that reaction. But I think that's the beauty of what behavioral science does. It gives you that another way to look at the invisible force field, as it may, and to kind of see what would drive people's behaviors, or you could even predict behaviors on that basis. Yeah.
But so with all of that knowledge, and we know that, you know, sometimes we just drone about because we have so many things to do. Where have you seen yourself fall prey to the same type of behaviors?
Biases.
And biases that the rest of the noobs.
Guilty.
Oh, I love that question. Okay, so let me tell you, I am equally susceptible to all these factors of influence. And it kind of brings us to the insight of, even now in today's show and people listening to us or watching us, only consciously what you're experiencing right now is 20%. All the other factors that we're not conscious of is also influencing us. And that goes for me, that goes for you, and it doesn't matter how much knowledge I have and insights that I have, I am still susceptible. Can you imagine right now that 80% of what's happening to us, we're not even aware of how it's affecting us? And so it brings us kind of back to, so in other words, answer your question, yes, I continuously am susceptible to these factors of influence. But I think maybe it's a nice segue to an analogy that I want to give people about how the brain works. And I use this analogy of, you know, your iOS system or your iPad. So our body is the hardware, and the software is the hard drive. It's the operating system. Mm-hmm. So the brain is the hard drive, and the operating system is working. And how that operating system starts to form is based on our experiences and how we grew up and bugs that we might have in our hard drive, etc. Mm-hmm. So all of this is happening, but the brain has evolved over these many thousands of years as an evolutionary superpower brain machine, because it's super efficient. It likes to do things quick and fast. Mm-hmm. And so a lot of our behaviors, we're creatures of habits, right? Most of our behaviors are habitual. Most of the decisions we make are very much biased, and often we stereotype. And stereotyping is actually, it's a bad thing in an interpersonal relationship way. So that's why we have to unstereotype. But stereotyping is a brain's mechanism to preserve energy so that it can make quick and easy decisions. So in other words, our brain is actually, the hard drive is there, and it's operating continuously based on past experiences. Yeah. And that's what's influencing our behavior. But when we go to school, we think, oh, great, we're going to become a better person or a better leader. And then we learn more stuff, but we're not actively updating our iOS system. Mm. And if we don't actively update our iOS system through intentional knowledge and awareness, such as the awareness like the cigarette packages, it has to be that wow effect. And then once you start to accept that and incorporate that, then you can start to look at the world from a different perspective, but you will always still be kind of like influence unconsciously. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I guess the last example that I can give to you that just comes to mind right now is, people say when I'm, you know, or you go on a date with someone, you go out or with friends, and they're like, you're a psychologist, right? You must be analyzing me right now. Like, I feel that you're looking at me weird. Like, you know,
they're so tense, they're so stiff, you know? And like, lighten up.
My bones are sweaty. Yeah. Exactly.
Or your friend saying, like, you're analyzing me. I'm like, of course I'm not doing that. You know, it's just, it's, I'm not. But
I'm off the clock.
I'm on break. But then it's the weekend.
Then you kind of said, like, but then I thought about that. And because you've intentionally learned so much, that over time your brain says everything that you've learned, like a language, you don't need to think about it anymore. So everything that I've learned in behavioral science, I've embedded into my unconscious toolkit, and I'm using it without knowing that I'm using it. And I think maybe that's a great example.
That's awesome. I mean, it's like, it's like your upgrade, you know, in a way. You keep upgrading your system, your iOS. It becomes part of who you are, and you know, throughout the years.
So on that topic of analyzing people, I'm not going to analyze you, but for the viewers, so let's say you're job hunting or you're looking to change industries, and you know somebody's making you a good offer. If you could give like two or three red flags about an organization, maybe that could help somebody preempt joining, perhaps a toxic environment, or you know, because I see a lot of this on TikTok where they're like, you know, read into this and
So kind of screen the company. Because often we get so excited, especially when there's not a lot of jobs available. And in that case, you kind of accept, you know.
Easily.
But what you're saying is, what you're asking is, can you screen, what would be questions or stuff, or what would be things you'd have to watch out for? Oh, God, that's a good question. I need to think. Look, there are many things. I think the interview process or the interview point of time is really important to get to know the other person. It's not just, remember, when you're going for an interview, it's not just you kind of being interviewed, but you should also take the opportunity to know more about, you know, when they ask you, oh, so do you have any questions? Yes, I have questions. Yes. I have a couple of questions I'd love to ask you. So don't be scared. Take that opportunity, because making the wrong decisions early on could really hurt you down the road. And you know, not every environment is positive. And so you can't always test the waters before you get into an organization. But there are questions that you can ask and then see how they respond to that. And I think that's maybe, you know, first of all, take the initiative. I think that's the most important thing. And then ask questions. I mean, you could ask questions in this, in the form of, you know, tell me how, you know, how are difficult situations solved in your organization? I mean, that's, I mean, it's not a typical question you'd ask in an interview. Or tell me, like, give me an example of, you know, what's a hero in your organization? I love that question. Because the hero is an embodiment of the values and the norms of what you should emulate in an organization. And then you can see how well you fit that.
Exactly.
Yeah. And if they have difficulties answering questions like that, or, you know, I not out of the top of my mind, I can think of a lot of questions right now, but if you can ask questions like that, that could give you an indication indirectly of how that organization might respond to things, or how they collaborate, or how they deal with difficult situations, or how transparent are you internally? Like, I think that's a really good one. I remember speaking, and this is a long time ago, I remember a company speaking to me and saying, we pride ourselves for being so transparent, and we pride ourselves for being so open. And then I don't remember the question I asked them anymore, but it was more along the lines, well, oh, could you share this example? Or could you share some stuff around this topic with me? And it's like, yeah, but this really depends, you know, and industry, and they're kind of moving away from the topic. And I was like, wait a minute, you're
if you're that transparent, can't you just give me a direct answer?
Completely contradictory to what they were saying. So I think that's maybe a good strategy. Ask them what they stand for, what their core values are, and then come up with potential questions that you could challenge any of, because a lot of them are like openness and respect and truth and, you know, authenticity, diversity,
be specific,
get into it. Give me some examples of how that works out in the organization. Or
that's very important. I mean, I just wrapped up a talent management course a few weeks ago, and you know, identifying organizational culture was the very first step from the organizational's point of view when they are trying to attract, or you know, you know, just continuing on to what you said, just creating that clarity of your goals, your values, your beliefs is everything to people, you know, looking to get in. So for sure.
And there's a discrepancy, because sometimes companies do that as an exercise, And so it's window dressing. Mm. And then do you really live up to those
values?
What's
behind that? Yes.
Yeah. And the lower the gap between those two, the more you know that that is truly
is real,
who they are. Yeah.
Yeah, because, you know, a couple of weeks ago on LinkedIn, somebody from my cohort actually shared the screenshot on our WhatsApp group. And the CEO of this organization was like, we're hiring. But if you want to be paid well and it's money and whatever else that you care about, this company is not for you. This is how we reward you. And if you're one of those people who, you know, you want to work a 9-to-5 job and, you know, you want to clock in, clock out, this company is not for you because our company, we are dedicated and motivated and we're going to do A, B, and C.
Right.
And he touched on like five topics. If you are looking for structure and policies and procedures, this isn't for you because we need to be flexible. And it was these five elements.
Sound like an innovation tech company.
Close.
Yeah.
And I saw this, so I went on. So I'm like, okay, translation. I'm like, we're going to underpay you, overwork you. We're going to shift the goalposts every 5 minutes because we're going to be changing things all the time. Yeah. And while you're at it, we're going to devalue in the market because they also said, you know, we're not going to pay for you to do any courses or anything like that because you're going to get all of the learning that you need while you're doing the job.
Yeah.
Granted, we learn a lot by doing, but some, you know, I mean, there is something to be said for doing a course, doing a degree.
External education.
So I was like, and they'll devalue you in the market while you're at it. Yeah. So,
well, look, if there's always this exchange, right? There has to be a fair exchange. You need to be happy because, again, there are people that do like that. There are people that do appreciate it. Look, there's difference in personalities and what people want to take out of work. Why do we work? We work because we want to fulfill a need. And a lot of people choose to become entrepreneurs because of those characteristics that you choose. Yeah. And then expect other people to be like that. But not everyone is like that. So again, for some people, it does work. And that to me doesn't have to be a red flag. It just means like, know what you want to take out of work and what you want to get out of it. And if there's a fair exchange, if they say, look, we're not going to give you a lot of money, but we will give you shares and equity, then you know why you're working, why you're doing. But if it's just like, no, we're just gonna dress you out, like I don't know if that's the right word, if we're gonna, you know, just
drag you out, stress you out, whatever,
then I don't think that's a good thing. No, then you have to be aware of that. But again, you know, it's about where do you feel your fit. And 75 years of talent management shows us that you shouldn't hire for skills, you should hire for attitude. Because nowadays things are changing so rapidly. But if someone doesn't have that attitude to fit with that environment, don't hire them. So it doesn't per se have to be a bad thing, but I do agree with you. Sometimes, you know, I think in today's world, some you know, owners, business owners and people who hire talent, they want to, I call it, they want to look for the lamb with the five legs, the sheep with the five legs. And they want you to fill in every single gap, 120%. Which I think it's counterintuitive.
Yes.
I actually think we should look for the sheep with the three legs. Why? Knowledge, experience, and motivation and expertise for three of them, let's say. But then the fourth leg, that should be the autonomy. Let the other person decide how they can bring themselves to work. Mm-hmm. And because more and more companies, luckily, are becoming more people-centric, and you know, mental health is now becoming a big thing. Diversity and inclusion is becoming a big thing. Sustainable human resource management is becoming more of a mindset that we're trying to come up with more better ways of how to make that work and feasible. And how do we stay away from those toxic environments where, you know, they come up and say, and I have to say this, you know, see us as your family, you know? No, the moment that the company says that to me, I run.
Oh, man.
Right? No, because then they're kind of like, family means you need to be loyal, you need to sacrifice.
Yeah.
And, you know, and look, if the pay is good, you know, if the pay is good, I'll go for that. But again, because you're getting connected through values, you need to make sure at least that the money is often
worth it.
It's worth
kind
it.
Of, yeah.
And then you can decide, and then you give yourself because you love the work.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But watch out when they, you know, in a very malicious way, use that. Come on, like, you know, see us as your family, you know. And no. That is, especially for the younger generation, they don't fall for that anymore.
No.
So, I mean, that's another thing that you need to kind of consider in that perspective.
So yeah, you don't have trouble at work. I'll give you a hug.
Yeah. Well, no, the hugs are fine. Yeah,
like here's a cookie. You
know, like, I think we actually have that. We have to have more mutual connections because, yes, if you want to create a family and you're really authentic about being a family and saying, look, the world out there is changing so much. Let's protect us each other, right? And we need to change. So we need to ask, we're asking more from human resources today. But if you're not giving the support mechanisms to get more out of people, people are going to burn. It's funny, right? You work for life to make more money and, you know, have a better health, but then eventually your health declines and then you have to pay money for to kind of improve your health again. So I think there's so much that we can still learn about how to make work a more sustainable place and a better place to be, because, you know, life and work is becoming so blurred nowadays. Yeah. Mm. So, yeah.
So I think on the other topic of analyzing people, because I know this is something you also lean into on your TikToks, 3 red flags in dating.
I mean,
there are so many.
Just three.
But we'll keep it short because we still have fire round questions for him.
No. This is good. Look, I just recorded my, you know, my podcast today. And every time, also, by the way, I'm writing this book called Red Flags, Green Flags, Modern Psychology for Everyday Drama. And this came out of the TikToks and the Reels. And apparently, you know, as I was speaking to the publisher, you know, it is such a hot topic. And, you know, of course, there's so much to say about red flags and green flags, and it's subjective. And, you know, it's you know, for one person, it could be a green flag. Mm. For another person, it could be a red flag. And maybe you see a red flag in someone and then you're actually the red flag. Mm. So there's a lot to be said about that. But I didn't realize until in the recent years, because of all of these changes, technology usage and whatnot, that a lot of us are losing our ability to be able to really engage effectively with humans, like you were saying before. We're losing that skill set, and we're also therefore losing the ability to really read people in that perspective. And that's where I see this whole red flag, green flag concept as something is really important and really beneficial. So so writing now the book about this, really psyched about this book. Because I'm going deep into the science. Of course, I allow my humor to come out, like in my TikToks and my Reels. So it's a kind of fine balance between science, you know, humor, but also addressing modern day phenomena. And I think that's what a lot of people are not doing. They're not looking at the modern world and how things are changing and how can we use that psychological lens to evaluate things. So that, putting the context there, modern dating has changed significantly. Like I said, it's become extremely toxic, and, you know, mobile devices and technology have played a major role in that. So what are some of the things that we have to watch out for? Okay, well, the field of dating is pretty large in that perspective. But I guess I have to choose a topic because there's so many red flags to talk about, right? So let me throw this back to you. Give me one specific field in dating that you would like me to talk about.
I don't know, it's been so long since.
It's been so long.
Like, thank God that part of my life is over.
Okay, so I have something for you, just to kind of take the sweat off. Maybe your spouses are watching.
Hi, Sarah.
Okay, so maybe some red flags when you first get to meet someone. I think that's really important. Yeah. Kind of like when you first get to work with a company. Mm. What are some things that you need to watch out for? And when we date people, and, well, dating is even seen so cumbersome nowadays, right? It's more a hookup culture because of the technology that makes everything so accessible. But when actually people decide to date and they want to get to know someone, there's a bias because, oh my God, no, I like this person. And, you know, you see them and everyone wants to put their best foot forward. So it becomes really hard to kind of figure out what is a real red flag because you're only seeing the great stuff. So I always say, if you want to find red flags, look for the small details in the behaviors, because people can't control everything they do. So what are some red flags when we get to know someone in the beginning? I think a red flag, one big red flag when you see this run, okay, is when someone says after the second date, I love you.
That quick attachment.
Very quick attachment style. Or they say, oh, you're the only one that understands me.
Yeah.
Right? Or I've never met anyone like you before. Right? Like, you know, those kind of over-exaggerated responses out of, you know, within a very short period of time that's often called love bombing, right? You shower people with gifts and
freaks,
stuff like that.
It freaks people out.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah. some people actually...
Some people gravitate towards it.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Some people gravitate towards that because... You know, they've maybe been in a not so great relationship and now they're getting the attention that they didn't get before or just kind of like their self-esteem. And then someone comes in and says all the right things.
Fills the gaps.
Yeah. So whenever it feels too good to be true,
it usually
maybe
is.
That's, it probably that, is. Maybe that's a great, good red flag to look at. Be more conscious about that. The second red flag to watch out for when dating someone new is... how do they deal with difficult situations, right? Because if you dive into the literature, and I mean, even in our, you know, just general wisdom is being able to deal with conflict and look at you, because you, both of you are in a very long-term relationships and married, right? Mm-hmm. So being able to deal with conflict is probably one of the most important factors, right? To make sure that you have someone that you can sustain yourself, because let's be honest, not all relationships are great. You have your ups. You're looking at your wife now, right? And you have your downs.
I was checking. She's still here.
Yeah. She's still here. She's still here. We all have our ups and our downs, and our relationships are going to be tough sometimes, and we're going to be put to the test. And that will happen multiple times throughout our relationship. You know, I myself have been also in very long relationships, so I know how that is. And so your ability to deal with those difficult moments and to get each other up and to learn from that, I think is you know, your inability. Your ability is a green flag. But when they're not able to do that and they get really frustrated with small things, or they get very much triggered by stuff that you just kind of like, why did you react that way? That can be definitely a red flag to look into. Not to say goodbye, but just kind of think about, is this something that I want to help them deal with? Because let's be honest, if you really want to date someone and be with someone more long-term, you're not only getting their great sides, you're also getting their... eras of further development in their lives, their traumas, right? They also bring that. And so relationships are about, can we learn from each other and can we be supportive to each other? And if people have very kind of unexpected reactions to very normal situations that you would feel that you need to deal with effectively together, that is a red flag and a moment of consideration.
Yeah. I mean, at the end of the day, we are animals.
Yeah.
You know, we are animals. So speaking of animals.
Right.
So, I mean,
that was
again,
a segue, right?
Yes, exactly.
He's been sitting on this one for a long time, but goodness. I also put another one. So you go, it's all yours.
No, I'm Take just because it. It's an interesting notion. Yeah. So, speaking of animals.
Yeah.
What kind of animal would you like to study, you know, and, you know, in a behavioral, you know, science sort of aspect perspective? Yeah.
That's a great question. Mm. Oh, my goodness. I guess there's a couple of animals. Well, I would, first of all, I'm not going to talk about them, but bees.
Oh, yeah.
I find bees very important, very interesting. The way they swarm together, they're so coordinated, their dedication to the colony and how they work, and everyone has a different specialization, the queen, and you know, I find it fascinating, right? Bees, and they produce honey, and it just, you know, they pollinate. They are so important, their impact.
Wow, that's a good one.
To each other and the environment. And as a behavioral, so I consider myself a behavioral psychologist, because I'm not only interested in the cognitive aspects of the individual, but how does the environment impact you? And how does it affect your behavior and your performance? And so I guess that is, and also the group dynamic, right? I find that very interesting. So I guess bees would be something that I would be interested in, but an actual animal or mammal would be dolphins. And what's the relationship between dolphins and bees? I think they have things that we can't see with our eyes. They have this kind of ability to pick up on frequencies, or their ability to pick up on well, dolphins have sonar, right?
Yes.
And I mean, I guess their ability to kind of see things, or to through their sonar to be able to pick up on things
and pick up
from miles away, and their altruism. They have this altruism, their ability to have empathy and support other people. You always heard the story of, if you fall in the water and a dolphin comes to save you, right? So which other animal has that? And I think dolphins are so highly intelligent. And I think maybe one of the reasons why we lack our abilities in terms of our cognitive performance, and this is just far-fetched, I know, but one of the ideas that I have is that I believe that they have this ability of sonar, or this kind of intelligence is because there may be more being and we humans are more wanting. So how you, and again, I saw this in a movie one day, you know, Lucy, I don't know if you saw that movie, Lucy.
Yeah, the dog. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And
oh, that, yes. Yeah. With a shaggy dog. Yes, yeah. I remember.
And I remembered hearing that. And again, I don't know if it's true or not, but their ability, that intelligence, that really got to me. And I would love to learn more about dolphins.
So, wow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I would have said elephants.
Elephants.
Why elephants?
I mean, well, number one, I'm South African. So my favorite place in the world is, you know, the Kruger National Park. But I would have said elephants because there's a really, you know, interesting structure within the herds. Yeah. And, you know, every herd has its matriarch, right? Yeah. And there's a very interesting phenomenon with elephants because the matriarch will have her second in command. So, you know, and I think this is just such a good metaphor for how we perhaps should be in society. But at that point in time where the matriarch starts becoming older and perhaps her responses are slower or her decision making isn't as good as what it was previously,
right,
there is this gradual transition of power where the second in command will just come in and take over.
Interesting.
There's no muss, there's no fuss. She then just steps in, takes the lead, and the erstwhile matriarch realizes for the benefit of the herd, it is now her time, and then they just...
Wonderful.
Go with it.
I wish we were like that in an organization.
Yeah, when I learned that, I thought, wow, if we could have, you know, sort of, self-awareness... And also know. That, you know, I think because, I mean, it's for the good of the herd. So if within an organization we had that self-awareness to realize, you know, I am no longer in my prime. And and it doesn't mean I wasn't doing a great job before, but maybe for this time now.
For the well-being of
Of the company, there might be somebody better
at the
positioned
moment.
To take to the serve. Lead.
This is, I love that analogy. Yeah. Mm. You know, it gets me thinking because tomorrow I have this event, an alumni event, where I talk about office politics, how to navigate office politics successfully. And I'm running another course as well on this topic. And it's a topic that often doesn't get addressed in graduate programs, right? We talk about leadership, but we don't talk about, you know, how to successfully navigate office politics in the workplace. And I think it has to do with the fact that there's such a taboo around it because we believe office politics, that must be toxic behaviors like backstabbing and gossiping.
No.
But office politics is about building social capital and alliances, finding mentors, you know, your reputation management. There's so much, and power, the concept of power, like you said. And that's what got me thinking. Maybe I can use that as an analogy tomorrow. How do we transition power? How do we attain, but also how do we give power?
Yeah.
And maybe on that note, this is a really, I think, a really interesting thing for the audience to listen to hear, is that we often think that getting power is, you know, this traditional way of thinking is the Machiavellian way.
Yeah.
I will attack and steal your power, right? Mm. But the science actually shows completely the opposite. So you giving people the platform like you're doing today, exactly how you're doing today, I want to put you in the right position. I want to give you the resources. I want to make you feel happy. So putting your social group and supporting your social group and taking care of them and giving them the limelight, actually people then will want to give you power in exchange for what you've done for them. So attaining power, so one of the ways you can attain power is by giving people resources and opportunities and putting them first, because then they know that you have their best interest at heart. So then they will naturally give you power. And then if you think about that concept, think about how do you translate that back into a business setting, right? Because most people think, no, I need to fight and I need to backstab and then that's how I'm going to get power. But that power is only short-lived.
Yes.
Yeah.
The getting power through kind of...
It's
not sustainable.
Yeah.
Yeah. But getting power through that interactive way of putting people, like even this podcast, the fact that you bring people here and you ask them questions and you want to hear about them, they naturally give you power. It's another way of looking at it.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's a great insight. Yeah.
There you go.
Power.
The power is here.
So,
maybe we can, next time in the future, we can do one on office politics.
Yeah, that would be awesome.
I think that's going to be
a very, very important hot topic for sure.
Maybe we could have some of your followers send in.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
Some tidbits, and we can address that.
From an organizational perspective, yeah. So I'll give you a premiere. Yeah. There we go. So as I'm writing this book, almost.
When is it?
The book is coming out. So Red Flags, Green Flags, Modern Psychology for Everyday Drama is coming out, I think, around the early next year, maybe around Valentine's Day. Mm-hmm. Of course, the book is not only it talks about human relationships in general and how modern life has impacted human relationships. And dating and relationships is two parts of the book. Mm-hmm. But the other two parts is work relationships.
Yeah.
And friendships as well. So, of course, these kind of topics will come back into the book. I'm also you're going to see that in my TikToks, and you're going to see that also in my Reels, is I'm going to start to transition more into work relationships and friendships, because I haven't been talking about that as much. So I'm going to transition that as I go with the book, and and in my podcasts are also going to be more about that as well.
Yeah.
And when is the podcast due to air or
good
stream?
Question. So I'm trying to record. I'm the person that tries to kind of create the series first and then see what we can do, and then just launch it step by step. And I want to align everything very strategically. So I'm taking my time a little bit. You guys are kind of like, create, pump out, create. And that's a really good way, because you can get a lot of feedback. But I want to kind of make it more aligned with the book itself. And I guess as I'm writing and developing stuff, that is also informing what I want to do with the book. So I think the podcast, I'd like to bring it out with the first episode around late July, maybe early August. But I probably will take snippets and post them as Reels and as TikToks.
Yeah, looking forward to seeing
Absolutely.
That.
Absolutely.
I'm so excited about this book.
Just listening to these topics, because, when it comes to friendships and office relationships, I mean, relationships, the romantic side, that's, it's got its own, target audience.
Yeah, totally.
But at the same time, that's just a wide array of uncharted territory sort of thing. You know what I mean? Yeah.
And also how the world has changed and impacted those relationships.
Yes.
And I guess that's the novelty that I want to bring to the table, kind of give that psychological explanation. Okay, this is what's happening to friendships and work relationships. And can we then use this behavioral lens to explain what's happening? And when is it, to your point, like you asked, when is it a green flag? And when is it a red flag? And more importantly, is when are you the red flag?
Because
we're so easy to judge other people.
Subconsciously,
right?
Subconsciously, yes.
And it also reminds me of that quote by Anais Nin. We don't see things as they are. We see things as we are.
Yeah.
That reflection. Yeah. Right.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Sign us up, Doc, for the book, for sure.
You guys are going to get a signed copy of the book.
Oh, bless. Yes.
Remember, looking forward to that. We can do a giveaway next time. Yeah, when the book's here.
Yeah, we can run that. So, should we go with some
so this is the fun part.
Yes.
So this is the fun part.
Okay.
We're almost wrapping up.
Okay.
We're going to hit you with some fire round questions.
Oh my goodness.
They're very, very light and fluffy. Yeah. Don't worry. But just like we're going to get some reactions on them. Okay. So first off, coffee or tea?
Coffee.
There you go.
By far.
Okay. Morning person or night owl?
Night owl. That one. Yeah.
100,000. Thousand
times now. So there's something about the darkness, man. I know. I share the same.
So they say that if you have a high degree of empathy, you perform better at night, because that is sort of when you can tune out all of the other stimulus.
100%. Yeah, and creativity as well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
My most creative moments happen at night.
Yeah.
Same. Absolutely. I always feel like if I have to like break the midnight hour before going, even if I'm like just staying at home, I can't feel like I'm going. So beaches or mountains?
Beaches.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, absolutely.
Dogs or cats?
Oof. People are going to hate me now for this answer.
Ooh.
I love cats. And you know why?
Why?
They're mysterious.
Oh.
And that's maybe a nice segue to, though I'm not that spiritual, I do feel like I have some kind of connection. I feel like that we should, like I said, when we look at the person holistically, we should look at them from all parts. And that spiritual side maybe is coming more out in me as I grow up. Get older, and that's why I love cats, and cats are mystic to me.
They are. I love cats.
Yeah.
Do you know that?
Yeah.
I mean, in the last 10,000 years, the genes of cats have not really
changed
much.
That's interesting,
right? So, whereas with dogs, if you take from where they came, it has changed so much that you cannot even see the connections, other than the fact that there's four paws and a waggy tail. So having a cat in your home is like having a wild animal, which is why cats are so independent and they can fend for themselves because they are still so closely linked to
and
their
not really
ancestors.
Attached. You know, they don't get attached.
That's amazing. That's an amazing insight. Yeah. God, we're learning so much in this podcast today.
So, sweet or savory?
Sweet.
All right.
Yeah. Yeah. Though I don't have that much of a sweet tooth, but I would choose sweet over savory.
Over savory. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Summer or winter, Dubai doesn't count.
100% summer.
It's like, winter. Yeah.
I was born in the Netherlands, so you know I'm used to rain. Mm-hmm. And so when I'm here working in Dubai most of the year, I'm just like, people complain about 50 degrees. No, I'm fine. I love it. So summer. Yeah.
Summer.
Okay. Okay. So cake or pie? That's in sweet. So.
Or tart, maybe. Or tart, he knows it as tart.
Strudel in a way, yeah.
Cake or pie or tart? Apple strudel.
Yes. Yeah. I knew it. I had a feeling.
You're going to get something else. Yeah.
Fiction or nonfiction?
Nonfiction.
Nonfiction.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So when you're reading a book, you tend towards that. Yeah. So you tend towards more nonfictious, novels or more literature.
I like that kind of insight more. Okay. Kind of what do kind of things teach me about life and, you know. And I don't like to dwell into fantasy, but I know that there's a lot of people, and I've been making TikToks about that, how people fall in love with fictional characters, and I've given kind of awareness to that a lot through the TikToks that I've done. And people fall in love with characters for multiple reasons. I won't go into it. That's maybe for next time. But it's interesting. But I acknowledge it. But I'm more a nonfiction person. Mm. Yeah.
Book or movie adaptation?
Movie adaptation.
Oh. Yes. Every time.
Yeah. Yeah.
Can you give us an example of one movie adaptation that was really, really good for you?
The Green Mile.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Ooh. Mr. Jingles.
Yes. Oh. That was such a beautiful movie. That was a movie.
It gets you every time.
Yeah. and I'm not sure if The Color Purple was a book as well. With
I think
Oprah
so.
Winfrey, yeah.
I think so.
That was a movie that really
I think they have a new adaptation coming out.
Really?
Yeah, I think next year.
Yeah.
A new, The Color Purple, not with Oprah, like a new, like, you know, younger actors.
Yeah. Different, yeah.
It's coming out next year, yeah.
But for sure, The Green Mile. What a beautiful, beautiful story. Yeah, yeah.
Netflix or YouTube?
God, what a comparison. Oh, my goodness. Again, dating. No, I'm joking. Oh, my goodness. YouTube. Because I don't have time and I don't watch TV. Mm. I hate TV. I don't watch TV. So Netflix, you can watch it on your computer, but I just don't. I have a Netflix subscription. I'm one of those people that just pays for it to have it when people come by and, hey, you want to watch Netflix? But I just don't watch it. So I watch more YouTube than
I do. You play the nature shows, you know, these like marine stuff, like just for the background, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
For me, it's always YouTube Wild Earth Channel.
Yeah.
Just like in the
or
background.
Or the fireplace.
Or the fireplace, yes.
Which is weird for somebody who likes summer.
Yeah. Warmth, right?
Yeah.
All right. Pen or pencil?
Pen. Yeah.
Okay. Still mightier than the sword.
Exactly. Yes. That's what I was thinking. Yeah. Yeah.
If you had to choose between two superpowers, so invisibility or super strength? I think I know that one.
No, I feel like he'd want to be Professor X.
No, Professor Xavier. Oh, no. He's too bold for me. No, I'd be.
They win McGregor one.
Yeah. Invisibility cloak. Mm. Yeah, invisibility cloak. I think that would be, because then you can kind of, a behavioral scientist.
Be the fly on the wall.
Exactly. Mm. I want to be the fly on the wall and listen in. And because then you really see how people actually are and behave. And then, because when people see you, presence of other people can influence your behavior.
Yeah.
So invisibility cloak.
Okay. Wow. Yeah. Interesting. I pegged you with strength because I thought, you know, invisibility, you know, you'll always be out there. You wouldn't want to, you know, be invisible. But in a way, in your context, yes, makes sense.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah. You know, and that's maybe just a really good point to point out is that people see you in social media. Social media happened as a joke. It happened as an experiment, part of research, you know, and I use the social media for my research, actually, just kind of picking up on behavior. And social media often has a negative impact on us, right?
Yeah.
When we read a lot about the research. And so I wanted to use social media to make people better, make them stronger and happier and healthier. And that's what a lot of my research has gone into. And so, thinking about that But anyway, I'll go too much into that.
Yeah, no,
let it go. I'll just let it go for now.
Yeah, I think that was a very
nice. That was a good one.
Yeah, that was a good note.
I think, you know, message received.
Yes.
Yes. There you go.
All right. Professor, thank you so much. This has been really amazing to have you on the show. Love the insights. I know everybody else that watches this episode will
feel the same. Like I said, the first time we've done this and sat down and had a real authentic chat.
Yeah.
And when we're in the class, we don't get to do that.
Yeah, because it's always bite-sized. And, there's always 75 people vying for attention. But
And even then, you don't have time to do it. So thank you for having me here.
Yeah. Oh, you're welcome.
I love this conversation.
Same. Absolutely.
And I wish you all the best with your show. I think you're doing an amazing job. So keep at it. I'm pretty sure that within a year or so, you're going to be the number one Dubai podcast that everyone's going to be on. So please remember me.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Sign mugs.
So let's cheer to that.
Cheers for the mugs.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, guys.
Cheers. Thank you so much.
That was a great session. There you go.
That's a good one.